And so that I've learned about in my prior work. So none of the data that I'm presenting is actually mine, but I think it's a really cool story that hopefully you find interesting. And so the question that I want to address is, why do we live fast and die young? This is a common question. Maybe you've heard it before, I don't know. But I'm basically interested in life history evolution. And part of life history evolution is understanding the pace of life. And this has important implications for understanding humans. And so the story that I'm going to talk about starts out like, is like a centuries old story, and starts with the search for our fountain of youth. And so back in the 16th century, Ponce de Leon and Christopher Columbus set out on this voyage to find the fountain of youth. And the fountain of youth was just this legendary spring that would restore the youth of anyone who drinks or bathes in its waters. Ironically enough, instead of finding the fountain of youth, they found Florida, which is today where a lot of old people go to die. But anyways, we haven't found the fountain of youth to say the least, and there's still tons of imagery of it in popular culture. So maybe you recognize a magic golden flower, rectangle, or this little pool from the guy. And so we have come to the fountain of youth. We talked a little bit about aging. And so aging, I just want to, this is a little, some review from earlier, from like last session. But I wanted to define for you how I, or how, what I think of aging is. And I define aging as simply the progressive decline, accumulation of deleterious changes that occur near the end of life. And we talked about how age is the number one risk factor for many human diseases, including cancer. And in terms of our endocrinology, it's associated with widespread dysfunction. And so we tend to see the breakdown of our growth hormone axes and our growth hormone pathway and our thyroid axis. And then an upregulation of adrenal activity, where you see higher levels of cort and higher levels of the androgens. And so we can't stop aging. I don't know that we ever will be able to, but if you look around the room, you'll see that people age at different rates. And so that's the question that I kind of want to look into today. And so these are just some of the most extreme examples of people that are really good at are really slow at aging, right? So they're really good at living. And so the oldest man ever to live, he died back in, only a couple of years ago, in 2013 at 119 years old. The oldest woman over here died at 122 years old. And I know I get told all the time that I look young for my age. So I think this is awesome. But if we look at around the globe, we can look at different life expectancies, and we see variation here as well. And so this is a map of global life expectancy at birth from the World Health Organization. And they found that between 2010 and 2013, the world average lifespan was 71 years old. Males have a shortly slighter on average lifespan. Hey, you got a question?
Disorders are related to aging, and in fact, females are much more likely to have endocrine disorders. That's kind of interesting.
Well, so, I'm not going to talk about that, but we can come back to that at the end of the question. So, so females do tend to live slightly longer, they have a slightly longer average lifespan of 73.5 years old. If you look across the nation, I just picked out the top and the bottom lifespans, and then the U.S. And so Japan has an average lifespan of 84 years old for both males, that's just like combined, males and females. The U.S. is ranked 34th in the world, so you have some sort of idea. We're at 79 years of age, and then the worst is Sierra Leone at 46 years of age. And now we talked a bit about, in section, about human studies and how they pose a lot of challenges for actually, for studying things, especially like life expectancy. And so there's a ton of socioeconomical and political and cultural reasons that may result in some of these differences. And so they're not necessarily a good system to directly study. And for that, we've had to look or we have to start looking at model organisms. And so in model organisms, I'm going to pose the question, what endocrinological differences may result in the extension of lifespan or the avoidance of aging? And believe it or not, the surprising answer might lie in the surprising growth pathway. And so this is review from lecture, all that we talked about. But we have our hypothalamus that's going to release GHRH and GHIH, and those are going to regulate the release of your growth hormone and your pituitary, and then your growth hormone is going to act at your muscle, at your liver, your muscle, and your bone to release IGF-1. And when we talked in class, we kind of stopped at IGF-1. We said, oh, well, it travels in the blood and it promotes bone growth. But I want to look a little bit deeper into what's going on at the cellular level when IGF-1 reaches its target cell. And so this is where our fun acronyms come into play. And so here's our representative cell. And here's our tyrosine kinase receptor that our IGF-1 is going to bind to. So when IGF-1 comes in, it binds to its receptor, and that's going to activate PI3 kinase over here, which is phosphatidyl inositide prekinase. Hopefully that sounds familiar, because that's come up before. PI3 kinase is going to phosphorylate and activate another kinase called PEK1, and that's it's 3-phosphatidyl inositide-dependent protein kinase 1. And then that's all going to phosphorylate another kinase called AKT. I have no idea why it's called AKT, when it stands for protein kinase B, but it's AKT nonetheless. And all that is going to inhibit this thing called FOXO. And FOXO stands for the O class of the 4K family of transcription factors. And yes?
Just a side note, actually, AKT, another bad name, BKT. So that's why they have.
Okay, there we go. So AKT, an acronym, is also BKT. And so FOXO is this transcription factor. And when there's IGF-1 bound, it's inhibited and stays in the cytoplasm and can't translate its target to the hormone, or transcribe its target. And so that's just what we see here. So we have no IGF-1 bound, it all comes apart, and the FOXO finds itself in the nucleus. And so the first kind of evidence that this pathway was involved in aging came surprisingly in a study done in 1993, a little bit up the road from here at UCSF by Cynthia Kenyon, in a little worm called the C. elegans. And so what Cynthia Kenyon et al. Found was that if they knocked out the C. elegans version of the IGF-1 receptor, it doubled the lifespan of a normal worm. And so here on our graph, we have days after hatching, or age, and then on our y-axis, we have the percent alive, or the numbers of worms that have survived. And so this white line represents just the normal lifespan of a worm, which is about a month. And then the black line represents the lifespan of a worm when you get rid of its IGF-1 receptors. And so not only, this was so shocking that it had such a large effect, but it's also important because not only did these worms living longer, they were healthier longer. So they didn't initiate the process of aging until much later on, and they maintained healthy and active lifestyles for much, much longer. However, things get a little more interesting in the next graph from their same exact study, where they found that any of those beneficial effects of knocking out the IGF-1 receptor were null and void when you got rid of your FOXO. And so the worm version of FOXO is called GAP16. And so in our graphs, we now have 4 lines. And the important one is this little triangle. And so this triangle over here is the worm that has neither IGF-1 nor FOXO. And without FOXO, it has a normal lifespan. And so this really suggests that the beneficial effects they were initially seeing were because FOXO was not being inhibited by IGF-1 like normally, and it was active. And so it brings me to the question, well, what exactly is FOXO responsible for? And it turns out so that FOXO does a lot, to say the least. And so we know that in humans, worms are a little simpler than us. They only have IGF-1. But in humans, both IGF-1 and insulin will affect FOXO behavior. And so in the absence of insulin, or any kind of insulin signaling, FOXO will activate 2002 genes. And this is a known number from the C. elegans. And I put this up here because I think it's shockingly large. It really drives home the importance of how a single change in your endocrinology can affect thousands of genes and have a large number effect on multiple phenotypes, right? And so all the genes that FOXO encodes for, the moral of the story is they promote longevity. And so I just have listed up here six major classes of target genes that FOXO will regulate. And so it's going to promote the expression of proteins involved, production of proteins involved in stress resistance. It's going to regulate your glucose and your lipid metabolism. It's going to inhibit cell replication. And that function is why it's especially important to be inhibited by IGF-1, because IGF-1 wants you to grow and enter mitosis, and you can't enter mitosis if your FOXO is active. It's going to also encode for proteins involved in DNA repair, so you're going to maintain healthy cells. It's going to code for my favorite thing, some of my favorite defense molecules are antioxidants, and also stuff involved in the immune system. Okay, and so there's been dozens and dozens and dozens of studies in our set of favorite lab models, the fruit fly, the lab mouse, our C. elegans, and our yeast, that have shown that putting our glucose and our growth hormone pathways together, if you affect any one of these areas, you're gonna have consequences for lifespan. And so anywhere above FOXO that you upregulate is gonna decrease lifespan, and anywhere you inhibit something above FOXO, you can increase lifespan. And so now the question remains, we have a really good set of candidate pathways that might be involved in aging in animals. Does this work in humans? And the short answer of it, and that I'm going to walk through a little bit right now, is yes, there is really good evidence for this. And so the first bit of evidence that's come is the way that we can get at this is looking at individuals in the population that age really well and seeing if they have differences in their insulin signaling. And so if you look at healthy centurions, so healthy individuals about 100 years old, we find that they have a unique set of metabolic characteristics. And so they tend to have low BMI, they don't have high fat, they have low levels of plasma glucose, and along with these two, they have low levels of insulin resistance. And so this is a graph, they took cohorts of individuals at different ages, and they saw that when you got to anywhere between 90 and 100 years old, the insulin resistance was super, super low. And so this is suggesting that even at an old age, those individuals are still really responsive to their insulin, and their pancreas is working really well. We also see that these individuals tend to have low levels of free insulin and IGF-1. So this is a graph for the IGF-1 binding protein, ratio of IGF-1 to IGF binding protein. I'm sorry, the resolution is pretty bad there. But the moral of the story is that the healthy 100-year-olds, there's slightly lower levels of free, or slightly high levels of free insulin compared to adults, but still better than a normally aged individual. All right, and things get more interesting when we look at direct links between IGF-1 and human lifespan. And so there's been a couple of studies that have identified among cohorts of super old Ashkenazi Jews and Japanese men variants or mutations in the IGF-1 receptor. And so if you alter these two amino acids in the receptor, it has huge consequences for the receptor number, so much produced, and their affinity. And so even though they find that they have slightly elevated levels of circulating IGF-1, because they have this mutant form of the receptor, that whatever IGF-1 is circulating is less effective and they're having a benefit for their lifespan. And we also see changes in FOXO that are related to human lifespan. And so there's humans, they have four versions of the FOXO gene. And so there's, if you look among different cohorts, and this is just a list of like cohorts that have been looked at in studies, you find that different variations in the gene that encodes for FOXO1 and FOXO3 are related to different aging in humans. But the last point that I want to talk about is because this pathway is so involved in regulating the pace of life, you don't necessarily need changes directly in your receptors or your FOXO gene to take advantage of this effect. And so this sort of brings a nice link between some of the cultural differences that may be at play in our worldwide differences in lifespan. And that's where diet and lifespan come into play. And so back during the days of the Great Depression, a bunch of scientists were interested as to thinking about what the effects of caloric restriction might have on humans. And so to do this, they took away calories of mice in the lab, and they were surprised to find that when you take away calories, you restrict the amount of the restricted diet, you can extend the lifespan up to 50%. And so I do want to be clear when we talk about caloric restriction, all the animals are still receiving the necessary nutrients they need for normal life. They just reduce the amount of like of their caloric. And so the dietary restriction has since been, this lifespan extension is expected to be related to the reduction in insulin and IGF-1 signaling. And so this is just an experiment where they had two groups, so the black line are dietary restricted animals, the top line is ad-lib fed animals, and you see that across their entire lifespan, they have lower levels of plasma IGF-1. And importantly, the effects of dietary restriction are potentially solely due to this glucose exposure, because changes in the glucose concentrations of animal diets alone is enough to have negative consequences for their lifespan. So maybe if we want to take advantage of this pathway and living longer, we just gotta have a hypoglycemic index diet. And then the last thing I want to leave you with is that there's also potential indirect effects above, like outside of insulin, that may be at play in regulating our FOXO, and that comes in with sirtuins. And so sirtuins are expressed during dietary restriction, and they are kind of like a nutrient sensor. So they will sense that there's low energy available, and they'll act to mobilize fat. However, they'll also interact directly with your FOXO, and they can activate it. And this sirtuin pathway, comes into play in popular culture because of resveratrol. And so when researchers saw beneficial effects of dietary restriction on lifespan, they looked for chemicals that could mimic those effects without altering their diet. And so one of those chemicals that they identified was resveratrol, and it's just a plant compound that will activate sirtuin. And it is found in red wine, which is where the whole idea that if you drink a glass of red wine every day, you'll have a longer lifespan. But please don't take this as an invitation to go just down a bottle of wine at like Thanksgiving dinner or whatever, because most of the studies that have been done looking at the effects of resveratrol on sirtuin, you would die from liver failure before you get enough resveratrol from your red wine to have huge effects on your FOXO. But so with that, if you don't take anything away, this is our whole pathway that I talked about. And hopefully I convince you a little